Welcome to all the viewers. In this afternoon EduSet session, we will discuss a very burning issue in today's discussion, and the issue which has already been displayed on our computer screen is the characteristics of employment and employment policy. This topic has been covered in our course material MEC 005, which is a master's degree course on Indian economic policy. This issue has also been covered in our BDP course EEC 12, and again the faculty is also running a certificate program in labor and development, and this issue has also been covered there. See, after economic reforms, although employment has remained an important issue throughout the planning period, but it has gained more importance, particularly in the post-reforms period. The reason simple being that employment growth has been very disappointing. Earlier we have witnessed the employment growth more than 2%, but in post-reforms period, in 99-2000 data shows that employment growth has been even less than 1%. So whereas we are enjoying that these reforms have brought a landmark change in the quality of the people's of life, the growth rate has increased substantially. It is more than 6% in the 1990s, but this growth is not reflected in the high growth of employment, meaning thereby whatever growth we have achieved, this growth is a jobless growth. That is one issue. So naturally questions arises, why this situation has happened? What are the serious issues of concern on the employment front? How do we measure the employment? And what are the policy implications? What sort of policy we should follow so that the people at masses can get the employment? This is one issue, that employment growth has been very slow. Another important issue is that although the contribution of agriculture and GDP has come down, but still employment is predominantly in agriculture. Even near about 60% people are still engaged in agriculture. They earn their livelihood from agriculture sector itself. And those who are employed in the rural areas or the rural workforce, the literacy rate is more than 52% people are illiterate. That means they have to get some sort of non-skilled or unskilled employment. Another important issue is that although the unemployment rate in India varies between 2% to 8%, although we will take up why this is 2% and on what basis it is 8% shortly, but the poverty ratio still is 26%, meaning thereby that there are the people who are employed, but those are poor. In one word, we can say that India is facing the problem of the working poor. So what are the policy implications of all these things and what should be done? We will take up all these issues one by one in today's discussion. My humble request at our to the students who are viewing our program from the different regional centers and the study centers is that they should not hesitate to ask any question relating to our topic. They can communicate their questions through our toll-free phone, which will shortly displayed at the screen. They can ask any question in Hindi or as well as in English. We will reply to answer your questions in the language you ask your questions. So today we have two set of experts. To the left, Professor M.S. Bhatt, who is professor of economics in Jamia Millia Islamia. he is having a long teaching experience at the postgraduate level. And towards my right is Dr. B.S. Prakash, who has 3-4 months back has joined with us as a reader in economics in the economics faculty. So this is the brief introduction about the topic and about the resource persons we have today on the dais. So after this brief introduction, I would like to hand over the dais to my colleague Dr. B.S. Prakash, and my specific question to him is that kindly enlighten our students what are the characteristics of employment. Dr. Prakash.
Thank you. Well, all of us are very well familiar that in our country, large percentage of workforce is still engaged in agriculture. Even in the 2001 census, as much as 61.5% of our workers were in agriculture. So, this sector, which has predominantly continued to occupy the prime of place in providing employment to such a large percentage of our workforce, it is they who should be under the focus. And is it happening in this era of liberalization? Is it possible that whatever policies we have been implementing, it is reaching them? This is our major concern, as my colleague Dr. Narayan Prasad just now mentioned. So, since large number of people are engaged in agriculture, we are very well familiar that this sector is always seasonal in nature. People there do not get employment regularly. So there is large scale underemployment, and therefore special policies are continued to be required to meet their needs. We are also familiar of one more connotation, that is the organized sector employment and the unorganized sector employment. All the people who are engaged in agriculture, they are going to be coming under the unorganized sector. There is no protection for them, as we see that it is there for a small percentage of people working in the organized sector. So it is very important for us to see at this stage whether the policies that the government is implementing is reaching that section or not, and if not, what corrective measures are required. So this is another important characteristic which we will be seeing it. We are also familiar that in employment, depending on the returns that they get, whether they get it in terms of wages or whether they get it in terms of profit, there is a dichotomized classification of wage employment and self-employment. So broadly, the characteristics of employment fall under these three categorizations. One is large-scale agricultural sector employment, which is falling in the unorganized sector. Secondly, there is large-scale agriculture labor. That is, you know, all of them are coming in the unorganized sector and they do not enjoy the protections that is enjoyed by the other half of the people, a minor portion, just about 7% of the total workforce, that is the organized sector. And the third is, they are most of them employed in their self-employment capacity. That is, if you do not take into consideration the sectoral classification of agriculture, etc., the total employment is split into a dichotomized segment in which the well-employed segment is very less and the self-employment segment is very large. This is, in brief, the characteristics of employment that we will be trying to further pursue to understand in our next course of study.
Thank you, Mr. Prakash. Actually, let us know first what the term employment refers to, because many a time layperson thinks that if he is on the job, he is employed. If he is not on the job, he is not employed. Does the same meaning applies to the student of economics or the subject economics? First, a little bit clarity about this, and then I would request Professor Bhatt to give some more characteristics. What are, other than these three, what are other characteristics of employment? Professor Bhatt.
Thank you, Dr. Prasad. And this is a very important topic. And in order to understand the characteristics of employment market in India, we have to keep in mind the characteristics of the Indian economy in general and then characteristics of the Indian labor market in particular. Because characteristics of the employment market or unemployment market are directly related to or flow from the structure of our economy. As all of us know, our economy is primarily an agrarian economy. And as my colleague Dr. Prashad said, that in an agrarian economy, agriculture or primary sector is the chief provider of employment. Therefore, in order to understand the characteristics of employment, characteristics of Indian agriculture has to be also kept in mind. This is one critical aspect. Another critical aspect of characteristics of the Indian labor market is that sometimes we see Indian labor market or employment market in terms of rural-urban division of labor market. Rural-urban division of labor market. That is another important characteristic of Indian. Second important characteristics of the Indian labor market is based on gender. Where we characterized Indian labor market in terms of, suppose, the percentage of women employed in the labor force, the percentage of women unemployed, the percentage of men unemployed, and sometimes the percentage of children unemployed employed in the labor market. This is yet another important characteristic of and then another important characteristics of the labor market is on the basis of age. Suppose we divide labor force unemployed or employed on the basis of age, and we found sharp variations or differences in different age groups as far as instance of employment or unemployment is concerned. Similarly, on the basis of special distribution and regional variations, we find lot of characteristics which are different from regional labor markets across the country. So these are some of the important things. As Dr. Prashad said, one of the interesting characteristics of the Indian labor market is what normally we in economics call disguised unemployment. Now, what is disguised unemployment? I will try to illustrate this with an example. Suppose there is a farmer and he has his own small piece of land and 10 people are working on that. They all belong to the same family. Now, if we remove out of 10, 5 people from that farm, and if the production output still does not decline, then we can say those 5 people were disguisedly unemployed. Or in technical terms, we say their productivity was very low. And in some cases, we say they are disguisedly unemployed, as famous economist Arthur Lewis or Mr. John Robinson says that their marginal productivity is very low in case of it is zero or even negative. So if we remove them from that household to put them some other work, the output in the household will not decrease. And this is a typical example of a disguised unemployment. And this type of disguised unemployment is very prevalent in Indian labor, Indian agriculture. So economists and policymakers suggest, and there are very important models which have been developed, that we can use this labor force for other economic activities, production activities outside the agriculture. Thereby, agriculture sector can serve as an important source of what we call supplying of labor to the other sectors of the economy. Similarly, as there are seasonal variations in our agriculture, there are times when in agriculture the demand for labor is very high. For example, when harvesting or transplantation season begins, there's a labor demand peaks up. But there are periods when the demand for labor in the agriculture is very low. So this characteristics of the Indian agriculture results into a situation or in a phenomena called seasonal unemployment. So this is yet another important feature of Indian labor market. Similarly, Indian labor market or employment market can be characterized in terms of organized or unorganized labor force. As we know, in the organized labor force, only 70% total labor force is employed. And out of that labor force, 3/4 is in the government sector. And what is left in the is in private non-agriculture establishments employing more than 10 people. Which means that 93% of our labor force is employed in the informal sector or unorganized sector. And this creates lot of socio-economic and political problems, because mostly this labor force is not governed by rules, regulations. They are not entitled to same benefits, and their wages are not assured in the same manner as the labor force in the organized sector. And also, their productivity is not only unassured, they are low, but their wages and incomes are also not certain. Sometimes they may earn sufficient amount of money, but for a larger period of time, they earn either very nominal wages, or sometimes they have to remain idle. And this results into a very important social and economic problem in urban areas. Lot of people from rural areas migrate to urban areas in search of jobs for these lean periods, and they work in very petty jobs, very unhygienic conditions, and thereby that also not only affects their productivity but also creates problems of urban planning, urban development, and urban living. So that is interesting. That's an interesting characteristics of Indian. Yet another interesting characteristics of Indian employment or labor market.
Thank you, Professor Bhatt. In fact, you have given in a very brief the important characteristics of employment. That the characteristics of Indian economy, characteristics of Indian agriculture, and characteristics of labor market are also reflected in the characteristics of employment. That is one important issue. So another important is that there is a dichotomy between organized and unorganized. There is a 7% workforce which is engaged in organized sector, which is highly protected, which are beneficiary of the development process, but there are 93% of the workforce which is not protected by the legislations, or whatever rules or laws have been enacted for them, they are not implemented in a proper manner. So really, this is the 93% of the workforce which is a serious issue of concern on the employment front. That is one important issue we will take up later on, because whole policy perspectives will round about this workforce. But before coming to this point, let us know how to measure the employment, what are the method to measure employment, because generally people are illiterate, they do not keep any record for their employment status throughout the year. But there are certain agencies, particularly NSSO and census, which publishes the data on employment. So what are the method? In a very brief, within 2-3 lines, I would request Dr. Prakash to throw light on this issue.
Thank you. I would like to begin with a small illustration to understand this measurement concept. Let us say a person who is on the lookout for employment, particularly in the rural areas, he goes to the labor market away from his house in the morning and he returns in the evening. And during the entire time period, let us say he either went on searching for work, but never found any employment, or he found employment which got him very meager earnings. Can we now say that the person was employed for the day? We are talking for the day because in the agricultural area sector, where majority of our workers are engaged, where most of them are agricultural labor, looking out for labor and earning some wages for the day, it is important to take into account the measurement of the unit as the day. It is different in the organized sector, where a person is continuously employed. So there we can talk in terms of long-term employment. But in the case of rural workers, it is necessary to take the concept of day's employment. So technically, although the person may be regarded as employed, it may not fit into the actual requirements of the definition of employment. It is possible that he was simply searching for employment and he never got, or he got for some hours and he earned very little income. Therefore, when we come to the measurement aspect, the time spent criteria or the income earned criteria, these two factors are very important. So in terms of the conceptual developments that took place, the ILO, International Labour Organization, it realized that in agrarian economies, where large number of people will be engaged in agriculture, it is necessary to have such aspects which will actually capture this kind of employment. And therefore, they advocated, and we have been adopting it since 1972-73, ever since the 27th round of NSSO was launched, three separate measures of employment. They are called as usual status approach, the current weekly status approach, and the current daily status approach. They are so called, they are termed differently, but and the meaning that goes behind each connotation is the reference period to which we measure the employment. In the usual status employment, we take 365 days, the preceding day of the survey, from the day on which the survey is done, the preceding 365 days is taken as the criteria. In the current weekly status, now we all know that they do not keep records, and if you ask anybody for how long were you employed during the last 1 year, it is very difficult for them to give a correct answer. Much of them will be wrong answer and guessed answer. Therefore, we take another concept: immediately preceding the day of the survey, during the last 1 week, for how long were you employed? This is based on the weekly status criteria, and therefore it is called as the current weekly status approach. We adopt one more criteria, which is called as the current daily status. So keeping the previous 1 week as under reference, the questions are asked to each respondent in such a way that they are asked to record whether they were employed for each day of the preceding week or not. So these are the three approaches that are adopted, and we can know by this that these measures are intended to bring out the chronic nature of employment as well as chronic nature of unemployment. Note that the employment and the unemployment measured in these terms are complementary in nature. We may be asking the respondent about for how long he was employed. Simultaneously, we are also getting information about for how long he was unemployed. So this is in brief the three methods that are popularly used not only in our country but in many countries in which the agrarian base is very strong and wide.
Thank you, Dr. Prakash. Actually, one issue which comes in everybody's mind: what is the harm if one remains unemployed? Some of the important thing, some of the implications or general understanding comes because one doesn't get income, and without income, how he will maintain his life? So if one remains unemployed, there are serious repercussions, serious implications for the individual, for his family, for the society, for the country as a whole. So Professor Bhatt, would you like to throw some light on this issue?
Thank you, Dr. Prasad. This is a very critical issue. Jo aadmi unemployed hai, wo उसको हम उसके कास्ट या उसके नुकसान को हम तीन चार एंगल से देख सकते हैं. एक एंगल ये है, एक नज़रिया ये है कि हम उसको उसके इंडिविजुअल जो उसको नुकसान होता है, द इंडिविजुअल कास्ट ऑफ अनएम्प्लॉयमेंट, कास्ट टू द इंडिविजुअल, एक एंगल वो है. दूसरा एंगल ये है कि जिस हाउस होल्ड को बिलोंग करता है उस पर उसके क्या नेगेटिव कॉन्सिक्वेंसेस हैं. तीसरा एंगल ये है कि उस सोसाइटी जिसमें वो रहता है उस पर उसके नेगेटिव कॉन्सिक्वेंसेस क्या हैं. काफ़ी स्टडीज हुई हैं हिंदुस्तान में भी और हिंदुस्तान से बाहर भी, जहां ये प्रूव किया गया है कि अनएम्प्लॉयमेंट के इकोनॉमिक, सोशल और पॉलिटिकल कास्ट्स हैं, इंडिविजुअल के लिए भी, हाउसहोल्ड के लिए भी और सोसाइटी के लिए भी. जहां तक इकोनॉमिक कास्ट ये है कि जितनी देर एक जिस टाइम फॉर द टाइम एन पर्सन रिमेन्स अनएम्प्लॉयड इज ए प्रोडक्टिविटी लॉस. ही इज नॉट अर्निंग एनीथिंग एंड इट एड्स ही एड्स टू द डिपेंडेंसी रेशियो. डिपेंडेंसी रेशियो क्या होता है? डिपेंडेंसी रेशियो एक रेशियो है कि एक घर में कितने लोग कमाते हैं और कितने लोगों को वो कमाने वाले लोगों को फीड करना पड़ता है. और जितना डिपेंडेंसी रेशियो हाई है उतना ये समझते हैं कि उस इकॉनमी की इकोनॉमिक कंडीशन उस घर की कमज़ोर हो जाती है. और जितना डिपेंडेंसी रेशियो कम हो जाता है उतना वो प्रॉस्परस हो जाते हैं. तो एक तो ये है कि अगर वो अनएम्प्लॉयड है डिपेंडेंसी रेशियो बढ़ेगा, वो कुछ नहीं कमाएगा. एक तो इकोनॉमिक बेनिफिट प्रोडक्शन लॉस है, इनकम लॉस है. दूसरा उसके साइकोलॉजिकल उस इंडिविजुअल पे असर पड़ता है. वो साइकोलॉजिकल मेंटल और फिजिकल टेंशन्स और एबरेशंस डेवलप हो जाती हैं और अपनी मेंटल बैलेंस लूज करता है और वो उसमें काफ़ी सारी एबनॉर्मलिटीज डेवलप हो जाती हैं. स्टडीज ने दिखाया गया है. सिमिलरली अनएम्प्लॉयमेंट का ये कि जो हमने मैन पावर ट्रेंड किया है उस पर काफ़ी सारा पैसा सोसाइटी ने खर्च किया है, उसका बेनिफिट सोसाइटी को नहीं मिल रहा है और उसके एडिशन में सोसाइटी को एडिशनल कास्ट इन टर्म्स ऑफ इन सम कंट्रीज अनएम्प्लॉयमेंट बेनिफिट के फॉर्म में देना पड़ता है. और इस तरह से सोसाइटी को भी अनएम्प्लॉयमेंट का कास्ट बेयर करना पड़ता है. इस तरह से सोशल अनरेस्ट बढ़ता है. हमने सुना है, पढ़ा है किताबों में कि एन आइडल मैन इज ब्रेन इज डिविल इज वर्कशॉप. तो वो जो बेकार रहता है, कोई काम नहीं करता है, तो उसमें नेगेटिव टेंडेंसीज डेवलप हो जाती हैं, कोई क्राइम्स में जाते हैं, कोई और किस्म के सोशल एबनॉर्मलिटीज अडॉप्ट करते हैं. तो इस तरह से वो सोसाइटी के लिए भी एक प्रॉब्लम बन जाती है. तो इस तरह से अनएम्प्लॉयमेंट के सोसाइटी को भी, इंडिविजुअल को भी और इकॉनमी को भी और साइकोलॉजिकल कॉस्ट भी बर्दाश्त करने पड़ते हैं, इकोनॉमिक कॉस्ट भी बर्दाश्त करने पड़ते हैं. और हर एंगल से अनएम्प्लॉयमेंट एक डिजायरेबल सिचुएशन नहीं है. और इसलिए अगर हमें ग्रोथ बढ़ानी है, प्रोडक्टिविटी बढ़ानी है, उसमें हर एम्प्लॉयबल पर्सन को अगर हम अनएम्प्लॉयड रखेंगे तो वो एक डायरेक्ट एज वेल एज इनडायरेक्ट लॉस सोसाइटी के लिए भी है, इंडिविजुअल के लिए भी है और हाउस होल्ड के लिए भी है. ये मेजर कास्ट्स हैं. क्योंकि सोसाइटी ने एजुकेशन पे काफ़ी खर्चा किया होता है, उनको अपब्रिंगिंग पेरेंट्स ने काफ़ी खर्चा किया होता है, और अगर वो ट्रेनिंग के बाद, पढ़ाने के बाद अनएम्प्लॉयड रहें तो ऑब्वियसली वो उस धन का, उस कैपिटल का सही उपयोग नहीं है.
थैंक यू प्रोफेसर भट्ट. हाँ, ही इज राइटली पॉइंटेड आउट देयर आर कॉस्ट नॉट ओनली इन इकोनॉमिक टर्म्स बट इन सोशल पॉलिटिकल टर्म्स ऑल्सो. Rather, it is the creator of the social tensions in the society. You can very well see that people take recourse to the militancy also if they remain unemployed, because one of the important factor, there are maybe many reasons, I think Professor Bhatt will agree because he belonged to that state. Many people are unemployed in militancy, particularly northeast states in Jammu and Kashmir. This is also one of the reason because people do not get employment. So, for making the order in the society, for ensuring harmony, social harmony in the society, for maintenance of the individual, for the country as well, it is desirable that employable people get the employment in the society. Now I come to the policy part. In fact, we have, if we divide or classify the different type of unemployed people, we can categorize them into 5 categories broadly, although it is not a very specific classification based on any principle or theory, rather for the analysis of the simplicity of the policy implications, we can divide into 5 categories. One is those who are already unemployed. Second category is that those who have become redundant, those who has been, due to the structural change or due to some reforms, people have rendered jobless. Third is the those who are working poor. Working poor means those who are self-employed, casual workers, wage-employed people, those who appears or those who are visible as employed but their incomes are so late that they are finding difficult to cross even the poverty line. Another is those very vulnerable people, SCs, STs, tribals. And then another category may be region specific unemployment, because that particular regions have not been developed, infrastructure facilities are not there, so they are unemployed. Particularly poor states like Bihar, Jharkhand and Orissa, like that thing. So for all these people, all types of these people, it is difficult to discuss all the policy implications in one session like this. So I would like to focus on those who are engaged in the agriculture sector as self-employed. Although they are considered as employed, they are counted as employed, but they are very poor. So their income is very poor, that means working poor. So what should be done to improve the employment conditions of those people who are working people? Dr. Prakash, you have worked for a long period in the institution like Institute of Applied Manpower Research and has done extremely and very advanced research in this area. Would you like to give some policy propositions to solve this problem from that point of view?
Thank you. Now let us focus once again on the different kind of dichotomized classifications that we have already discussed. We in the initial part of our talk brought out that 7% of workers who are engaged in organized sector, they are having lot of legislative provisions which protects their interests and also gives them several social security provisions. But what is happening is 93% of our population workforce who are in the unorganized sector are not getting the benefit of any social security provision for them. Although there have been acts like Minimum Wages Act which should take into consideration their requirements and their protection of interests also, we very well know that even these minimum wages also vary widely from one state to another state. Now we all know that as recently as in 2005, our government enacted one new act which was called as the National Rural Employment Guarantee Act. This act, which was passed in the parliament in 2005, has now been implemented in a number of states. Initially, they have implemented this in 200 districts of the country, and gradually it is proposed to be expanded to other states also. Now, what it means is the employment policies that have been pursued by our government for the last 50 years of our independence, with all that, though the poverty level has been substantially brought down to 25% from the more than 50% which was prevailing at the time we got our independence, we still need such kind of acts to continue, such kind of programs to be continued. But what is happening is this particular type of provision which enables them to get day-to-day wage employment does not improve their capacity. It does not give them any skills on which they can depend for getting better wages and continued wages. As long as these acts will give them day-to-day wage employment, they will get some wages, but the moment this program is withdrawn, they do not have any capacity to sustain themselves. That means all these programs have been palliative in nature. Therefore, simultaneously, there is a need to engage the policy attention, focus the policy towards capacity building. and that is covered under our Sarva Shiksha Abhiyan, the universalization of elementary education policy. Through that, the government's aim is to bring a minimum level of education up to 8 years of schooling to all the children, so that they have some skill formation, some literacy level, some numeracy skills which is required for them to pursue any kind of employment. Simultaneously, since the wage employment is very low and the self-employment is very high, we have been concentrating on giving special provisions for promotion of self-employment. This can be by way of skill development or training for that, or supplying raw materials to them, or giving them credit facilities, so on and so forth. Whatever are the policy thrust that we have pursued for all these years, the fact still remains that a number of people are still continuing to depend on daily wages alone, and that too in the agricultural sector, where the focus has to be more concrete and more, you know, focused. And this is where, you know, the recently enacted government has appointed a commission for taking into consideration the interests of the unorganized sectors. And you, some of you must have read in the papers of the last 2 or 3 days that an unorganized sector social security provision bill is trying to be brought out. And this is in nutshell what the government has been doing. And there are a number of issues coming under that, and I hope it will be covered in our remaining part of the session by others.
Thank you, Dr. Prakash. Actually, one of the important issue which comes up in the discussion, that it is not only the question of generating the employment for those sections, it is the question of generating the productive employment, because their income will only increase when they get higher wages than what they are earning now. Because when productivity will be higher, obviously then only any employer will be able to give higher wages. So how to increase the productive employment? And Professor Bhatt, would you like to say something on this issue?
In order to increase productive employment, we have to drastically restructure our manpower planning approach, our training programs approach, or in general educational planning approach. For instance, there is a mismatch between demand and supply. There is a demand for a certain type of skilled manpower, but there are a lot of people who have no skills. So lot of programs have to be taken, a lot of new institutional framework has to be developed, wherein skill formation as per the demand has to be taken up on a large scale, particularly in rural areas. Generally, we say if growth increases, there's a debate, growth increases, it automatically take care of unemployment. Historically speaking, this has not happened. As Dr. Prasad rightly said earlier, that it has in 80s and 90s have been the growthless, what you call jobless growth. Therefore, we have to rethink on this issue, that what should be the pattern of growth which will also create jobs, or which will not be a jobless growth. And there is a need for serious rethinking, restructuring on that account. Similarly, there is need for taking a relook, not necessarily in the way it is being propagated, on the labor laws or on the protections available to the people in the unorganized sector. For example, the Minimum Wage Act is there in operation for a long time, but it is rarely being implemented in its true spirit. Therefore, even if we put new labor laws which will favor the people in the unorganized sector, therefore remove their take care of their problems, but unless these are properly implemented, enforced, they are not going to deliver results. Therefore, while it is true that we need to change or modify the existing labor laws, wage contracts, but at the same time it must be seen that those wage contracts and those labor change in labor laws must not necessarily favor the more prosperous sections in the employment market, and they must be properly implemented. Similarly, there is need for reforms in the agriculture sector. For example, lot of casualization has taken place in the rural areas. Landlessness is on the rise, and small and marginal farm holdings are increasing. More than 70-80% holdings are accounted by, even by the official estimates, by small and marginal holdings. And given the technology available, these holdings are bound to become non-viable. Therefore, if these are to become viable, then the people employed in these small holdings or owning these small holdings have to be provided proper technology. And therefore, it highlights the need for research and development in these areas. Or in case it is not possible to provide a technology, then these people have to be supplemented with alternative productive employment opportunities. That is not happening. Therefore, this problem is going to compound. So this is yet another important area wherein we should think seriously about structural changes in the rural area, reforms in the rural areas, agrarian structure and labor laws and other important related issues, institutional framework. There have been committees after committees, but actually on the implementation level, very little has been done, and we need to reorient our implementation mechanisms, monitoring mechanisms, evaluation mechanisms, which will say, have these reforms, are these laws, are these programs and strategies really benefited those people for whom they were implemented? The available evidence suggests they have not done. Therefore, there is a need for rethink, a serious rethink on all levels on this front.
Thank you, Professor. But I think time is running very fast. So far, let me summarize what has been deliberated upon in this session. In the beginning, we explained what are the characteristics of employment. There is dichotomy between organized and unorganized, and predominance of unorganized nature of employment, rural and urban, then quality versus quantitative. These are the some of the important characteristics of the employment. Then we also elaborated how to measure the employment. It is the time frame on the basis of which we NSSO adopts three concepts: usual principal status, current daily status, current weekly status. Then we also pointed out what are the major concerns of employment. Then we also took why employment is essential. If somebody remains unemployed, what are its implications? Implications are far-reaching, not only for individual, but for the society, for the household, and for the economy as a whole. Rather, it creates a social disharmony and a social tensions in the society. So, it is a very serious issue. And then, there are several types of unemployment, which are one of which we discussed the policy implications. One issue is the working poor. Those who are employed in rural areas are illiterate, and the precise nature of unemployment is disguised. Although they appear to be employed, but their productivity is very lower. So what should be done in this front, on this front? Professor Bhatt and both Dr. Prakash has elaborated. I think policy suggestions were very quite constructive and worth taking note of. With these words, I would like to thank Professor M.S. Bhatt, who has spared time to come for acting as a resource person for this teleconferencing sessions. So thank you, sir.